batting like 500 on having pants on when your parents show up. You know, when I'm up super late and I know that, I don't know, I had too much to drink and I'm stumbling around and I don't want to snore and wake up Bonnie, I'll go to the guest room upstairs. But the problem is, like, I'll wake up and I'll hear your mom's voice downstairs and I'll realize I lack the equipment to gracefully make it from the upstairs bedroom to our downstairs to put on pants. And so there's this, you just got to own it. And so at some point you march down in your t-shirt and underwear like, hello, Liz. How are you? It's good to see you. It's harder with your dad. Like, howdy, Butch. How are you? I'd shake your hand, but that would be weird for both of us.
Yeah.
To this room now.
He's like, Brian.
Beautiful folks, it is Tuesday night, and that means it has got to be go time for the show dedicated to farting around on the internet. Hello, beautiful folks. I'm Brian Brushwood in Austin, Texas, joined by my BFF and OAK. It's JRY. What is going on, Justin?
Holy crap, Brian. This is, this has been a hell of a couple weeks. You know, ever since Germany invaded Poland, things have really escalated.
You know, I thought just when things couldn't get weirder, yeah. Appeasement.
Yeah, turns out that Neville Chamberlain's a real character. Anyway, that ends Diamond Club in 1930s, the limited edition audio series where just, Brian and I do the podcast from different moments in history.
Just pretend that was on old-timey radio. We're like,
oh, have you heard of that Hitler? He's invaded our Poland. What are we going to do about that? Let's have butt sex.
I don't know. Let's ask Postini.
Ah, oh, Postini. Yeah, it's so good to have you on the show. I'm glad you're seeing fit and alive, and I believe you'll live forever.
Oh, I'm doing so many things now that I am a young man.
Well, being a young man and in control as you are, Postini, yeah, do you have any advice for the kids out there?
Yeah, I believe all the... Wait, I'm Italian. Yay, Mussolini! He's great! What could go wrong? Ah, pizza pie!
Oh, all right, let's hear from Postini. This episode brought to you by Buster Brown Shoes. They're brown shoes that go on your feet.
And by Squarespace.
They'll be invented in 80 years.
So anyway, yeah, there's that.
Hey, man, dude, it's been a big, fat, 10-day stretch since we did one of these.
We last did a show in Orlando, live at CreateCon, at the fantastic, amazing, awesome CreateCon in downtown Orlando. Man, that was great. That was the idea of a weekend where it's one day con, one day just hanging out. Like, that's amazing. Which I guess that's kind of what everybody else's con normally is, right? It's just like a lot of hanging out.
Hold on. Time out. Like, in the middle, Bonnie sees this clip because Bonnie doesn't watch the show. She had never seen this before. She sees the clip of me in Orlando, and then her eyes get as big as dinner plates, and she turns and she goes, oh, you're wearing the same shirt. And yes, indeed, I am wearing the same shirt as I did 1 week ago. Miracles are true.
Yeah, dreams do. Well, I think you are you wearing an undershirt? All right, this is the most boring part of this. all right. So, yeah, we were in Orlando. We had a great time. Where do we want to start? I mean, do we want to start chronologically?
Yeah,
here's what's going to happen. We had an amazing, epic, baller Disney experience. I then went to Gen Con. Brian went to Def Con. And now we rejoin you, having both come back from those big, gigantic, epic adventures, which were probably more of business opportunities for us than necessarily us kind of just luxuriating and having a great time, right?
If by that you mean we worked hard as hell and tried to walk away with some kind of rumination that would make it worth our while, then yes, that's exactly what those con experiences were. Unlike the blissful, magical 12-hour day that was day drinking around the world with all of Diamond Club at Disney. It was utterly amazing.
Hashtag Big Diz, as it was coined by the one and only Bryce Neshcom Castillo. Where do we start? Where I mean, like, because I mean, feel like
the story begins with us realizing that it's not just you, me, and three random chat realmers. You and I realize that that without running a convention, we somehow have attracted fully half the members of CreateCon for our day drinking extravaganza.
Because this was literally just something where we both realized we were going to Orlando and we're like, oh, dude, we're definitely day drinking through Epcot, right? Like, that's just the thing that was happening. And we just said it live on the show. And so then it became this big Diamond Club thing, which was super awesome. And we just want to go through some of the highlights, or do we want to go like blow by blow?
Can I tell you my personal highlight was watching first of all, we somehow managed to get 78 people in to Disney all without paying a single thing, because everybody knew somebody who knew a cast member, and then the few people who looked like they almost might have to pay, all of a sudden PDF documents came out of, you know, the back coat pocket of Lonely.geek, and all of a sudden it's like, ha, we're in. And so we start walking forward, and first of all, can we talk about the debate? I don't think we've talked about the debate.
No, we have not. Nothing that has happened we talked about that during that day.
The dress is either...
Which is odd because it feels like last year. Like, I can't even imagine... I can't fathom the fact that we haven't had an episode in between that and now, because so much stuff has happened.
Agreed. But basically, 2016's version of the black and blue versus white and gold dress happened when all of a sudden this Rorschach test of when drinking around the world at Epcot, do you go clockwise or counterclockwise? Do you go clockwise starting in Mexico, going around the world and ending in Canada, or do you do the reverse?
And my opinion, and I believe I represent the opinion of Floridian locals, is you start in England and or Canada and you work your way through to Mexico. You go counterclockwise around the lake. You were very much of the opinion that you start in Mexico.
Correct. And Curtis Larock nailed it. Liquor before beer, never fear. Beer then liquor, never sicker. We're going to start with some tequila and margaritas.
Number one, like... let's not imagine that, like, you can't get liquor in these other countries, and you can. It's not like they're like, well, no, it's Mexico, only tequila for you. Like, sorry, Tecate is more like get the hell out of here, A's. You know, like
more like Tecate's. Am I right?
Yeah, exactly. We hate them, and then they throw down a glass of Tecate's and step on it. Like,
yes.
You know, that's you can always get any kind of liquor that you want anywhere. Like,
sure. But
they have Canadian whiskey in Canada.
Okay, all right. Which would you rather have in the scorching hot, blistering heat of noon in Orlando? Would you rather have a taco and a cool margarita, or poutine and a Labatt's?
Either way, and so this is literally, we're on the bus going to Epcot, and Brian is arguing his fact, but all he's doing is exactly what he just did, which is just repeating two different things, but saying the second one in a different voice. Where he's like, hey, what would you rather have? Margaritas? Delicious, savory margaritas? Or beer? Ew, beer. And I'm like, you're not making an argument. You're just saying it in a weird voice.
All right, look.
Yeah,
all right,
welcome to every argument we've ever had.
Let's put this.
Is it Brian's? Brian's like, oh, would you rather our kids go to private school where kids will get a good education, or public school where everybody's talking like that?
All right, no, and I think you bring up a good point. Who's right? Brian, who fairly represents the facts, or Justin and Bonnie, who just talk like this?
So we eventually settle on the fact that, like, hey, look, we'll start in Mexico, and that's how that's how we'll get it kicked off. Things got off to, I think we got very, very early on.
there was an early rush.
We figured out that there was just not going, like, Disney was not meant to hold us when when we were a denied entry to the Three Caballeros ride in Mexico, because we were all drinking and had all just bought booze. And so we just blocked the entrance for a solid 15 minutes and then realized that everybody was just never going to be on the same page where we didn't have booze in our hands. So we left.
Yeah, so we kept on going, and to be honest, like, you know, there was a bit of kind of like a stilted, like, well, we're all here to party, so I guess we should be drinking or whatever, but it wasn't until we got to Germany, and then just some dude busts out a soccer ball, and all of a sudden, like, it starts to feel real. Wait, hold on, back that video up, because in the background, there's a random Jay Brushwood. In the background.
Oh, look at that. Yeah.
That does look a lot like Jay.
Let's also pay attention to this video. So this is us in Germany, right? Time Jumper, the Don of Patreon, spots us for a big round of Jaeger bomb shots. Or just Jaeger shots.
Sure.
So we all toast to Jaeger. But let's go ahead and just run this forward.
Oh, you motherfucker.
Go ahead. Oh, wait.
We cheers. Hold okay. On. Throw it back.
Yeah, everybody's down in the shots. Look at old Sippy.
He takes... Brian takes one sip of the Jaeger, goes, ew, and then he's like...
Okay, all right.
Hold on.
However, that's true. In my defense, I did not attempt a bicycle kick 20 minutes later.
Wait, hold on. This ain't about me.
Apparently,
Brian, I'm giving you a red card for that is the deflection of the highest order. Not going to skip over the fact that you tried to sip on a Jaeger shot just because the bicycle kick did indeed happen, not for 15 minutes later.
Oh my God, this is amazing.
Ugh. So anyway, by the way, Bryce, I think it's fair to say is maybe the least enthusiastic about sports out of all of us, right?
I mean, I get sports, but yeah, I'm not into sports so much.
Dude, you turned into MF and Pele. like you had the eye of the tiger all of a sudden, and so, you were going to kick that ball.
And so no one was taking video. We had been taking like 5 or 10 minutes of video just playing football with these guys.
Just waiting for that kid to get it.
And, and so they kick it over to us, and it's kind of waist level. And so I'm like, you know what? I played soccer when I was in elementary school. I can hit a ball.
Balls.
And I fell flat on my ass and spilled a little bit of my my cream liqueur drink.
You spilled a little bit of your self-respect.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez. It was I tried. No. No self-respect.
Sorry.
Fail.
By the way, what is the video name? Because we're showing a lot of footage. This was put together by Leon, right?
Leon, yeah. That's right. BBpedia videos on YouTube. Just hashtag Big Diz. BIGDIZ. The Diamond Club goes to Disney World. He aggregated all of the social media posts and ended up putting it together into an hour and 40 minute summary of our day. That was amazing.
That is an hour and 40 minute found footage documentary.
And he put it together.
It is amazing.
Before we got home. I remember we were on the way home and I was like, oh, Leon's already put it all together. And it looks beautiful. He's taking shit from Snapchat, from Vine, from Twitter. So good.
So we're making our way through the various countries.
Hold on. I feel like we got to jump forward right to the money moment.
With the boat?
Yeah. So everybody agrees that we're going to jump over. It's 3 in the afternoon. They agree that we're going to just jaunt on over to the Magic Kingdom just for a wee bit where a couple of fast passes await us.
Let's understand the logistical issues that we have here, right? Because we are rolling with, like, what's our posse? Like
20.
Like
20. 20 plus.
At the end of the day, it was 20.
Easily.
20 plus. We are all rowdy. Easy to say, we are very, very rowdy. And now, also because none of us have paid to get in, we need to make sure that everybody can still get in. Everybody who's not on a park hopper pass gets to Magic Kingdom. So we got to get 20 people from Epcot, drunk people from Epcot to Magic Kingdom. We wind up getting on the ferry into the Magic Kingdom.
Which, by the way, everybody was against the ferry. You all had monorail fever, and I was the only one who wanted to be on a boat. And then finally, when I went running over there, everybody was like, oh, I guess we're doing the boat. And then we just hear this voice going, ahoy.
Ahoy there. All right, so at some point, we are, it becomes known to us that we need to get...
Oh, goon game cheese.
So, okay, so it becomes clear. Anyway,
the sounds you're hearing are a bunch of really drunk people who have just taken down, like, you know, drank all the way around the world and are now running to the, you know, the Magic Kingdom, the happiest place on earth.
You were not dropping F-bombs at Disney, were you?
They were magical fairy bombs.
No, that's bad. Disney has children.
And indeed they did, as we began our new mission to, like, when you're on a road trip and you see a 18-wheeler by, the goal is to get him to pull the horn. And
you climb, pulling the giant bird. I'm doing a foghorn.
So now we eventually come to the conclusion that that has to happen with the guy who is piloting the ferry from, you know, wherever the stop is on the monorail to Magic Kingdom. Now, we are discussing this with the same kind of quiet, muted conversation that you would imagine 20 drunk people would be able to muster. The glass or plastic between us and the captain is not soundproof. Right? So yeah, we certainly hear us loudly going, hey, we should get him to pull the horn.
But my favorite part was once we all got on the same phrase, the same phase, as if we're all children of the corn, we all turned and faced with one arm up and waited patiently to catch his eye. And he just kept not looking our way. It was extraordinary. And then at some point, somebody opened the door, kind of glancing at us, talking at him, and they had a conversation, and strangely, he never looked over at us while we all waited, and we realized he's intentionally not going to catch our eye because he knows we're all going to pull our arms down at the same time and beg him to honk the horn.
So let's just go ahead with the audio live from a Big Diz. This is what happened. Wait, like, hold on. Keep it going.
Begrudgingly.
We broke him.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. That was the funniest shit ever.
So.
Thank you, Dan.
He does a fancy bow.
It morphs.
You deserve it.
The moment, like, we went so far beyond what was appropriate. Like, oh, God, Dan no. already took a bow, and then we just keep on going.
Everybody is just trying to have a quiet day at Disney. We're just like, Scotty Emo said in the chat room, that we were just a roving professional wrestling crowd, just like yelling and chanting and clapping.
Captain Dan!
Yeah, so then, but then we get to actually realize something that was foretold 4 years ago, right?
Yeah, well, this was on our first album. Ira told a story of a time that I was at the Magic Kingdom with Brett the Amtrekker Rounceville, and we tested this little hypothesis that if you start cheering for random presidents, that everybody else during the Hall of Presidents roll call, the rest of the crowd will buy into the idea that that's apparently a thing that you should do and start cheering for their own presidents. So we had 20 people, which was effectively a third of the audience for the Hall of Presidents, and decided that we were all going to do this. So this was going to be the loudest, most boisterous, opinionated Hall of Presidents roll call in history.
So there were two rules, like, go ahead and figure out whoever you want to cheer for. Like, go ahead and have your own private favorite president. But there are two rules. We all love William Howard Taft, and we all hate Lyndon Baines Johnson. Like, when LBJ shows up, you would not go so far as to boo, but you would be like, shh.
I don't know. Have you heard the audio of when LBJ came up?
Yeah, no, they definitely booed. they like seriously hated him.
It was, I think, the most boisterous reaction that LBJ has ever gotten. In fact, I'm sure that the attendants there were shocked. at somebody was booing a president, especially not like a current one that's like controversial or something.
The best part was the confusion around, like, because even before it began, I remember saying like, oh man, I just love presidents. And then the chick in the row in front of me turns around like, the fuck is with this guy?
So let's go to some of this audio here.
Seems profoundly simple that we should choose our own leaders.
Oh, let's skip ahead a little bit.
Yeah, that's some, it's a little bit of,
Dwight D. Eisenhower. John F. Kennedy. Lyndon B. Johnson. Richard M. Nixon. Gerald R. Ford.
Yep!
Ronald Reagan. George Bush. George W. Bush. And now we come to the present. A present that is rooted in our...
This was... All right, so Brian... You were not there when the initial story was done. This has become something that like has been a meme within our community
Sure. For
years and years and years. How would you describe your first this experiment there in the Hall of Presidents?
Oh, dude, it was extraordinary. Like you could tell from the first time someone cheered, you could feel that wave of everyone's like, well, I guess I got to pick a favorite.
Exactly. Where it's just like, all of a sudden, like, is that a thing? Did I just miss that? Like my entire childhood where you're supposed to cheer for your favorite president? Who's my favorite president?
My favorite was the waves of laughter that would happen in the awkward silence that followed like George Herbert Walker Bush.
Yeah, like, no. As soon as people start cheering loudly, the punchline is really who doesn't get cheered for.
Yes, yes. Anyway, it was amazing and magical.
So we spill out of there, and it is just like we're on cloud nine, and we decide we're gonna go to the haunted mansion.
Yeah, and by the way, we come out marching. I hope there's video of this because our savior shows up. Like we come out like excited, like a youth church group, clapping in unison, and we just saw our heroes. And then this guy Gerald shows up. And he's just like, oh, what's going on? And we're like, well, oh.
Okay, so no, let's also understand. We were a roving gang. Like, you undersell it in just saying, like, oh, we were just, no. We were walking in one big mass, yelling at the top of our lungs and clapping, Haunted Mansion!
Clap, 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 clap.
And eventually.
They took the gentlest push and they ran with it. People hate presidents. I love them.
Now we're going to the Haunted Mansion.
By the way, we now have a handler. I'm pretty sure he was dispatched once we...
to deal with our yelling.
It becomes fairly clear very quickly that somebody has come to head us off at the pass to like, hey, all right, do you guys just want to go to the Haunted Mansion to skip the line just to move us into an indoor facility? And they're like, oh, yeah. So we all just get... pushed right
we get the
through.
VIP treatment. They take us in through the back entrance. They set us up. We go straight to the front of the line. We skip the 45-minute line by virtue of just being a bunch of loud yelling jagoffs.
So that is basically we destroy Magic Kingdom. Between we had a benefactor who works there at the park. We had Zach Holder who was also helping out logistically, but we crushed. Hall of Presidents, Haunted Mansion, Big Thunder Mountain, the
Space
new
Mountain.
Minecart ride with the Seven Dwarves, and Space Mountain
in one hour.
And of an hour and a half.
In what? Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
That is a record.
Like, right?
I mean, that but, is a
And 20 people.
All together.
All that's 20 people got on every ride, basically.
Crazy. I don't
How
think I did that.
That.
With their whole season pass. I don't think I got to read. You know, I went like all the time with the girls and like we get one ride in.
It was pretty amazing. And okay, now one of the things is because we keep getting these opportunities to skip the line, we push back and we realize it's getting closer and closer to 9 o'clock.
Well, one thing before we get to our big run, literally. Every time that we bring 20 people through a ride at the exact same time, you hear that logistically, they've got to recalculate the weight, right? So because it's Disney, they don't just say, hey, 20 drunken marauders are going to delay your time. They have to have the Disney way of saying it. So we're in the line for the Seven Dwarves ride, and the person up front's like, yeah, how many? And they're like, 20. We're like, Seven Dwarves! And then you just hear over the loudspeaker, hello, riders. It appears as if some poison apples have been discovered, and the line will now take an extra 10 minutes. We apologize.
Are you serious? Yeah, poisoned apples? They called you poisoned apples?
They said that the dwarves got into some poisoned apples,
yeah,
and it may be a little bit longer.
They're meaning you guys drank the apples that are now poisoned.
Hey man, I'm not judging.
We're just like, seven dwarves,
seven dwarves, seven dwarves.
Oh my gosh.
Sleepy, sleepy.
Oh my goodness.
So we're busting through all these. It's an amazing time. We are moving shockingly fast considering everybody's got to pee every 5 seconds because we've been drinking all day, and it's just we're just a real scattered mess. We're moving like SEAL Team 6, considering.
Sure.
And then we realize we have to make a decision on where we're going to watch the fireworks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. Well, and so there's a 9 o'clock show at Epcot, the Illuminations, and it's a delightful show that happens like super any minute, so we got to rush back if we're going to catch that one. And then there's like, you know, the world famous, you know, brand new projection onto the Magic Castle thing. The difference is, yes, we've all seen Illuminations a billion fucking times.
And it's not great. I mean, it's fine. It's
show.
Very good for a fireworks show, but considering Disney is like the world leader in this kind of stuff,
correct,
they do a lot better at other places.
And yes, the newest, hottest show in all of theme parks is the projection show at Magic Castle. However,
only one of those two places has beer.
And which one is that, Brian?
I mean, you know, Illuminations, right? You know, over there in Epcot?
Epcot, where we just came from like 2 hours ago.
Seems like the only thing that makes sense is for us to rush onto that monorail, come zooming up, look at our watch, realize there's 20 minutes to go, and we got a mile and a half to jog all the way to England if we're going to make it in time to the Rose and Crown Pub. And so sure enough, the first annual inaugural Diamond Club 5K... begins.
We break out of that monorail as if there was a racing fanfare and a starter's pistol. It is like, imagine a dog track where instead of there being a rabbit, there's just a pint. Like, that's like, we're like, we're in our cross country kind of gait. We're just like trying to trot at the right pace. We're dodging past everybody at the Carousel of Progress. We're making spin moves at the Coca-Cola Museum. And people just start falling away as Brian and I are at the tip of this spear. It starts out with like 8 people, and eventually there's just like falling back. But Brian and I are just eyes on the prize. Like, gotta get to the Rose and Crown. Gotta get to the Rose and Crown.
What's crazy is, like, you guys weren't that far ahead of everybody. Like, they were only a couple of minutes behind.
Don't take this away from us, Bryce.
Just saying, everyone had a chance to get their drinks that night.
Well, and so we get there, and so we're like, oh, okay, we're gonna do a Guinness, and another Guinness, and a harp, and another harp. And they're like, well, do you want any fries? And it was like, fish and chips? And they're like, yeah, fish and chips or whatever. And
yeah, we, so two fish and chips, two Guinness, two harps.
Right. And then 5 minutes pass, they ring the bell for last call. And as if it's Pavlov's bell, Justin involuntarily says, you know what? Why don't we do two more harps? Let's just go. We haven't even gotten our drinks yet, and Justin's ordering our third round.
Oh my god!
So we settle in. Brian and I are outside of the Rose and Crown. It is now last call, but we doomsday prepped, and we go down for fish and chips,
which
at 3 rounds, so we can enjoy the fireworks.
By the way,
meant to be enjoyed.
By the way, that was far and away the best ending to an Epcot day ever, because we had all the beers there and we were all gathered and we're all holed up and we were able to outlast everyone. Everybody left, and it wasn't until like an hour and 15 minutes after the show ended that security is doing a sweep and they come over and spot us and they're like, hey, so you guys are still here.
No, we definitely, dude, we got night watchmen. Like, that was, like we're just sitting up there in England having a great time, BS, and we finally met up with Garrett and Joss, who were eating a late dinner in Japan, and we're just bull-effing around, and next thing you know, this, like, very kindly, you know, young lady who was, like, the last sweep through the park is just like, what are you guys doing here? Like, you know, literally everybody has left. You're holding up the last bus to wherever you're going.
And we're like, so there's only one bus and there's nobody left. They're like, yes, yes. And we're like, so like the moment we get on the bus, he'll just act like he's our driver and take us wherever we want to go. It's like, yeah. And we're like, all right, well then. And so we hop on the bus and we're like, to the All-Star Music, Jeeves. And off we went.
I got it.
Wrapped it up.
I gotta say, I am so glad I wasn't there. I've been horrified the whole time.
Oh, no, you wouldn't.
Cuss words.
Oh, no. Bonnie, just,
look at you assholes. You guys are a bunch of assholes. I am so.
So this is a photo of them at the hold up for the fireworks. Yeah. What you don't see in this photo is anybody else in the party, because these two guys take a table for themselves with their eight drinks while we're sitting on trash cans.
I believe it. And do you know what Brian would be doing? Like, I'd be like walking over and be like, hey, where's my seat? And he's like, oh, here's some trash, baby. Can you throw that away? Or, no. You know, I'd be like, fuck you.
All right. Number one. Here's the weirdest thing about Epcot is everybody's in Britain, but they're actually British. Do you notice that?
That's so weird.
All the British people went to Britain to watch the fireworks?
Yes. Yes.
Like, I think we're going to go to London in like 2 months, and I will, between the Epcot and Magic Kingdom trip that day and then Typhoon Lagoon that I went to the next day, I think I will have heard more regular British accents in Disney than I will in London. Like, British people love Disney on a scale that you can barely fathom anybody loving anything.
Oh,
and
dude,
so
because
the reason why
it's just a 6-hour flight away for them, right? It's just like, oh, hop, beep, boop, over the pond.
Over the water, a spot of Disney then. All right. But then, like, they don't go to Mexico. They don't go to Morocco. They don't go to Canada. They go to, like, all right, well, finally we're here. Oh, it's a proper British pub, I guess. So the reason why everybody else wasn't there is because they were also, like, kind of fussy and mean, as some people are at the end of a long day at the park. So, like, a couple people got, like, yelled at by actual British people in England about, like, blocking their view and everything. It was a weird scene. Also, Brian and I are dicks and decided to take an entire table because we had 9 beers between us.
I mean, all right.
Well, it did occur to me that for the same amount of money that you wind up spending at Epcot, you could probably go to a country a year and do a real, you know, like if you...
Hey, by the way, what's up with Morocco being run by nothing but Obama clones? Every single person I saw in Morocco, if he was male, he could stand in for Obama.
I mean, man, there's a lot of handsome people at Epcot. That is absolutely true. Everybody is, and apparently, I forget who was telling me this.
All right, Scotty Mo says, wow, Brian, in the chat. You were there, Scotty Mo. Tell me I'm wrong.
There was
Barack
also
this... Obama.
Somebody was telling me that if you go on some of the message boards, like that for all the people that, because they're all kids on internships from these various countries.
Correct.
They have like this work, live, stipend. So they all live in dorms on Disney property. And apparently it is just, you know, all the message boards just point out that the Italians will, you know, that they will F anything, including the doorknobs. Like, they just run roughshod through the dorms. And so, like, all I could think of when we were in Italy is just like, all right, man, like, A, pay attention to how wide the smiles are and don't shake anyone's hand because those people are getting work done.
Yeah. Hey, man.
I will say about Morocco, it was the only time, and it might be the only time ever in my life, that I will have a beer bought for me by a bartender in Disney.
Whoa.
Ooh. Wait, did that happen?
It happened in Morocco. I was like, I got another whatever like bleep blop beer that they had there, and I was like about to pay, and he's like, oh, yeah, no, don't worry. Also,
ooh,
there's this.
Oh, my God.
Hey, speaking of paying for things at Disney, Brian.
Uh-oh.
Well, number one, Brian forgot to book a hotel room.
I didn't forget. I have always believed in the kindness of strangers.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, my God. Am I telling you? I'm glad I didn't go.
All right. In my defense.
I forgot to book a hotel room.
All right. Fine.
And not just at Disney, but also for CreateCon.
It's fine. It all worked out.
Brian made sure that my room had two beds. And I'm like, well, Brian, why don't you stay in my room? Okay, cool. So we were at the Aloft for CreateCon. It's a fun time. Everybody's having a great time. And Brian at some point just drops on me like, hey, yeah, let's we'll figure out a way to split it. Also, there's a few charges on the room because I got some stuff and I charge it to the room. And I'm like, okay, cool.
It was like four beers and Cheez-Its.
Sure, yeah. I mean, I didn't know what it was. I didn't check it. Whatever. They charge the card on the room and that's it. Then Brian also doesn't have a room for Disney. So we get a room and through some connections. And so Brian and I have a room. But at Disney, they got this thing where you have
so good.
You have like an NFC wristband.
Yeah. They tag you like an endangered polar bear.
And we're like, okay, let's just run around with these, and instead of running a card or worrying about anything else, we can just charge stuff to the room. Brian also makes a bold proclamation at the beginning of the day.
I say, hey, you obviously paid for the hotel room at CreateCon. I imagine between all the drinking that we're doing in the hotel room, there's going to be an expense here. Why don't we have it switched over to my card and I'll pay for this and that'll make up. And then that way the scales will be balanced, right?
Yeah. But Brian is also, this is kind of a gamble because whatever it is here is what he pays. And there's certainly a large possibility that we could run up. It's very easy to spend a lot of money at Disney.
By the way, flash forward to about 12 minutes later when Justin announces he's buying a round of Jaeger shots for everybody in Germany. The moment it's determined that Brian will pay for this.
Oh, my God.
I mean, I want to make sure. Like, it was like a $500 tab at the Aloft. So I'm like, listen, Brian's like this. I'm going to get my worth out of this. I'm not going to get conned by Brian for like, hey, I don't know. Maybe shots shouldn't happen. It's like, no, shots are happening. This is my special day. Don't ruin it.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, we start running up the tab. It's not as large as we would expect because Time Jumper a few times jumped in and wound up picking up tabs and everything that was like really, really nice and amazing by him. But there is one little thing. At the end of the night...
Okay, so it's now like 1 a.m.
Oh, God.
We have to get on a plane in exactly 4 hours.
Yeah.
We're just going to lay down. And so I pick up the phone and I call and I say, hey, what's it take for me to to change over to my credit card?
And you can only imagine that this comes with all the tact and precision of somebody who's been drinking in the Florida sun all day. That Brian's like, hey, and of course we're all around each other. We're trying to make each other laugh. So Brian's just like, hey, skiddly beep bop doo. I want to know how much we spent. And they're like, we can't tell you that. And he's like, Well, I just want to know, so just if you can go ahead and move along any things that you need. We just need a total to do, and we're going to start to take bets. Hey, everybody, what do you think? Above 400, below 400. Man, the betting's getting hot and heavy here in this room. You better tell us.
This is shockingly close to exactly how it went.
Very accurate.
And so eventually we find out how much it is. I don't know, Brian, do you want to say how much
it was? Yeah, sure. We were shocked and amazed that between the hotel room and an entire day of just using this wristband like it was magic, the total was only 380, which, you know what, under 200 a piece was not bad, right, Bon?
I don't know. You had a lot of fun while I didn't.
Hey, who's going to San Diego tomorrow?
Do I get to just charge on that wristband? Is that my fun? I think I just had a lot more fun.
So Brian then asks, hey, can you just switch it to my card?
And they say, absolutely. I just need you to come on down to the office and we'll knock that out. To which I reply, see, I don't want to do that. I'm like real comfy right now.
You sound like your brother.
Don't want to leave. So let's say, you know, you just do the bleep, blop, bloop, and all of a sudden it's on my card. And they say, no, that's not a thing we do. And I say, and I look at Justin and I'm like, how you like PayPal, buddy?
So yeah, Brian's just like, oh, yeah, whatever. Bleep, blop, boop, ba-doo. I'll give you $400. All right. There we go. Hang up the phone. Which is great. Except for the fact that I still haven't received my $400.
Do you know why, Justin? Because there's a grave injustice.
Oh, yeah?
I'm still waiting on my $1 pledge from somebody at patreon.com/nightattack.
And I'll tell you what, and indeed, some legends say that the Brian waits all day and night for that $1 pledge at patreon.com/nightattack. Well, that's where he will remain until the dollar pledge comes in for the legend of the kindly lesbian and the young Brazilian ward. Dictates that there is... there is only one way to break the curse, and that is to go to patreon.com/nightattack and donate $1 an episode.
Yes, legends say that you can be an amazing wizard like Curtis Bailey. That's right. Curtis Bailey.
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 Bailey.
Curtis Bailey.
Curtis Bailey.
Curtis Bailey.
Curtis Bailey.
Curtis Bailey.
Good or not, it's Curtis Bailey, ain't it?
Curtis Bailey.
Oh, that's a good one.
Curtis Bailey. Oh, you bent Curtis Bailey, did you? I'm afraid he's busy contributing to Night Attack.
Curtis Bailey.
At some point, one of these people is going to be, this is why you need to watch the show live. I want one of these days, the person who donates is going to be in the chat. So anyway, be like Curtis Bailey and go ahead and throw us a nickel for lickles and a dime in your rind.
Grind with the dime? Or
so, we made it home. And yeah. I assume you and I got well-rested and had an entire week to get back to sorts.
No, because literally the next day, I wound up going to Typhoon Lagoon with my little brother, who's 10 years old. And I will let anybody and everybody know that a 10-year-old native Floridian has the swimming skills of a Navy SEAL. All he wanted to do was just live in the gigantic, comically oversized wave pool of Typhoon Lagoon. as he was just swimming out into the, he's like, oh, come on, Justin, come on. Let's go out of the deep end. And I'm just like, he was just like the most adorably soul-crushing soul cycle instructor ever. He was just always like, no, come on, we can be out here. We can be out here. That's fine. That's fine. And he's like in water that he couldn't even touch if he dove down as far as he can. And I'm just like, okay, that's fine. Sure. Oh, we're making such magical moments together. We're bonding. Brothers for life, right? I'm going to die.
Well, and so when was this a surprise to you? Because you didn't mention this when I was there.
No, this was it was the plan that I was always going to meet up with my stepfather and my little brother, but I did not know we were doing Typhoon Lagoon. I thought we were going to do like Universal or another theme park where it would have been a lot of me trying to find shade. Instead, it was a very, very active day in the sun again.
That's hilarious.
And it was definitely definitely something that we had to I had to get through, get back home, and then we both prepare for yet another great adventure.
Yeah, man. So you head out for Gen Con immediately, or you have a couple of days off, or what?
A day. Get back on Tuesday, and then leave Wednesday morning.
Yeah.
Wednesday evening, sorry.
So, yeah, that's roughly what I got. I got back on Monday. I had Tuesday off, and then Wednesday immediately headed back on the road. It was insane.
So you went to DEF CON.
Yeah, but by way of Matt King's house.
Oh, yeah, because you shot Scam's cool stuff, right?
Yeah, well, it was one of those things where it's like, hey, let's just do DEF CON, and that'll be great. And then at some point, like, Matt King writes me saying, like, hey, didn't you say you're going to be in Vegas for DEF CON? I saw the DEF CONs happening. You want to get together? And I was like, oh, shoot, yeah, no, I totally should. This is a dream come true. As long as I've been a magician, I'd love to hang out with Matt King. And he's like, yeah, if you want to shoot some Scam Schools, we can make that happen too. I'm like, oh, geez, well, I guess we got to do that. And so I reach out to Bryce, and I'm like, hey, man, you want to fly on out, do a night of shoots, and then fly back? And then
Well, it first was, hey, do you want to come to Vegas for a week? Because I'm on the companion pass.
Well, what's wrong? I mean, why wouldn't you want to be in Vegas?
Because like, Vegas is expensive, and I don't have anything to do for a week, and I have edits to make.
I mean, okay. Well, I mean, Vegas is made of
things. For the slack. Jesus. Yeah, we don't.
Yeah, Jesus,
I'm just trying to tell the story here.
Yeah, no, I mean, look, you want to bag on Vegas. Save that for the Vegas podcast. We're talking about the Night Attack podcast. And so we schedule that, and so we all get together and barely make it in time for Matt King's show. And, of course, it's the best comedy magic show in all of Vegas. And then we go.
For those people who don't know, Matt King, amongst magicians, Matt King is revered as the guy who figured it out. He's got a great show. It's in the day, so he still has his nights. Effectively, he has the perfect magic gig. He can wake up at like 10, 11, do his show or two in the middle of the afternoon. He is revered as being amazing at what he does. He's very, very funny. He's well-liked. And then he still has his evenings to do whatever he wants. Like, he is the ideal for working magicians of what you would want with a Vegas rep.
Yeah. Well, and so we decide, we don't really find a more Scam School-y kind of venue. So we decide we'll just go to his place. And then he hits me up. He's like, hey, I hope you don't mind. Do you know who Michael Gudeau is? And Michael Gudeau, I've listened to for 10 years. He's the sidekick of Pendulette on Penn's podcast and also on his radio show. And we saw him perform when he was performing with Lance Burton and so on. And I'm like, do I? He's like, yeah, anyway, I thought I'd bring him over. And I was like, yeah, that'd be great. And so we land, hit the ground running. We do the show. We get four episodes of content. These are Scam School episodes that take place in Matt King's kitchen, and it's gold. I cannot wait to see these. But the next day, we're getting ready. I guess the next day we get everything set for DEF CON, and the whole time Darren Kitchen's just like, you're not ready. You're not ready. Those doors are going to open, and there's going to be ravenous beasts looking for all your amazing stuff. You better bring your A-game, bro. You better have all your scammiest scams and all your social engineeringest engineering, because these guys are going to tear you apart. You're going to love it. And then the morning of Thursday, or I guess Friday morning, we get up. I get up early. I'm the first one out of bed. I take a shower. I get all cleaned up, get dressed up, And I think, man, you know, let me make lots of room in my backpack because I don't know how everything's going to go. I may need to stuff a bunch of stuff in the backpack. And I pull out, you know, here's this garbage that I knew that was in there, this other garbage. And then I go to reach for my laptop.
Yeah. So, I mean, you have your, this is the white laptop, right? Or
this. Yeah. Yeah. It's not there.
Wait. No, but this is the laptop that you bring
everywhere.
Everywhere, yeah. Right? It has the touch screen and everything. Like,
yeah.
I remember
when
California for that whole summer,
you
lived off that thing. It was, right. It was a gigantic, very important part of your living on the road. It's your lifeline.
Yeah. Not just that. It's filled with a lot of personally sensitive information. And it is not in my backpack at DEF CON.
So at DEF CON, again, a collection of the most elite hackers, both white hat and black hat, that there are, as well as government agencies, contractors, all of which are trying to compete with each other to see who can own the most random traffic at Vegas as they set up honeypots and then, blast personal information on gigantic screens to prove what they are doing to their peers.
Yeah. So it occurs to me like, well, maybe I just misplaced it. And then I look in the other bag and it's like, when you only have two bags, there's not a lot of places to look and it's not neither of the bags. And then I think, oh man, maybe I left it at home. So I call Bonnie. I'm like, hey, this is an emergency. Will you please look for the bag? Because again, like if you read any of the guides about going to DEF CON, it's like, don't leave anything without, you know, out, not touching you, because if it's in arm's reach, it'll vanish. And there's genuine black hat hackers who will grab stuff to do blah, 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 blah.
Yeah. So, and, I mean, just for an example, there was a thing I think last year where a few people made a charging station that you would normally see all over the place at conventions where you could plug in your laptop to charge. And it was a free charging thing. It was also a completely set up honeypot. So people would charge their phones and just on instinct hit the trust this computer button so they could completely own their cell phones. Like there is elaborate stuff that goes on.
Yeah. So it occurs to me like, okay, so this is the highest concentration of black hat hackers, people who know how to extort and blackmail people and cause trouble. And of course I'm flashing back to hacking the system where I say like, hey man, don't worry about getting ripped off for money. Get worried about your information getting ripped off. Cause that's a nightmare that is a living death that never ends. and I realize
that the biggest, flashiest trophies that, even just random people can hang on their walls are owning the social media accounts.
Yeah. For
especially big famous people that have gigantic social media followings.
Well, especially ones who have
made shows called Hacking the System.
Yeah. So this is, by the way, this is all occurring to me less than an hour from Marketplace opening. Like the whole reason we've spent thousands and thousands of dollars to get all the stuff out there so that we can be there to sell stuff from our little booth and take scam stuff, hopefully into a bigger marketplace. And all I'm thinking about is how many passwords can I change? How fast? So I start changing literally every password I can think of. And I call Bonnie and she's like, no, it's not here. And then I remember, oh shit. I definitely remember taking out my laptop and putting it in one of those gray bins at the TSA. It definitely came with me. It definitely should be here. It definitely is stolen. So I start changing every password I possibly can. I get like 20 or 30 passwords in. And then I realize, and there's this one moment of panic so deep that it occurs to me, oh yeah, this is what nightmares feel like. This is usually this is the part where I wake up. And then I'm like, yeah, I'm not waking up. This is not a nightmare. This is whoopsie doodle. It's happening. And so defeated. I'm like, I call Bonnie and I send out a note to Tom Merritt, to Bryce, to Brant, to Bonnie, and say, hi guys. This is super messed up, but I can't focus on anything but running our little booth at DEF CON right now because there's too much money that we've invested. We've got to sell some stuff. Otherwise, I'm letting everybody down. This is where we're at. You guys think together, come up with some answers, and implement them. Bye. Peace out, Brian out. And so I'm.
You just outsourced how to solve this problem?
I mean, what am I gonna do? I can't check out from the booth because I flew in people from Kentucky. I flew in, John has scheduled 5 days out there. It's like we spent thousands and thousands of dollars to make this happen. I can't, and a lot of it is dependent on me being there to sign stuff and hobnob and shake hands and help them sell. So I get there. And I'm just like, put it aside. There's nothing you could do about it. And meanwhile, I'm thinking like, okay, well, you know, it's mainly a cloud-based computer. It's all cloud-based accounts. It's like, but then they still, they're going to
It's already logged into stuff.
Right, exactly, It's logged in. And plus also, it's like everything encrypted. In the download directory, I'm like, did I download any spreadsheets with budgets or any of that stuff? And I'm thinking like, the whole history is like, Brian loves pornography. Who knew? Only people who bought any album we've listened to. but at any rate, I'm just like, get your head straight. It'll be fine. And then I walk in and Brent is on the phone talking to Austin TSA and he locks eyes with me and he goes, oh no, he's here. He's here right now. Here. And it turns out that they had a laptop matching the description of this white laptop.
Oh, damn!
And they had me give the password on it, and they verified that it's mine. And they said, "Come pick it up when you get back." And it was like this way. I've never been so happy to be such a fucking dumbass. It was amazing.
Can we also just take a minute for people who have listened to this show for a long time?
God damn it. Is this the irony alert? Are you about to rip? This is an irony alert, isn't it?
This is an irony alert. This is a 5-alarm irony alert. Because how would you describe your relationship with the Austin Airport TSA?
Frosty.
Same airport where Brian has sat on the floor to protest how long it was taking for him to get frisked. He has had multiple experiences where you've gone against them, and yet when you were in your dire hour, there was your hero, your knight in shining armor, Austin TSA. And by the way, I've always been on your side. Austin TSA was also where my famous thank you for enforcing the letter of the law and not the spirit.
It's not the spirit, sir.
A fife playing moment, existed for me. So they are a prickly bunch. And it is very odd that they were your hero there. So I'm glad a healing moment for everybody as they were your heroes.
There was one other moment. Do we have time? Can I share another moment?
Sure. Yeah.
So halfway through that day, of course, the moment I find out that the laptop's fine and there's no mounting attack coming, I'm like, everything's great. And then I see somebody walk past the booth. Now, keep in mind, the booth is to my right is a bunch of lockpicking stuff, the escape shims and a bunch of escape from handcuffs and thumb cuff stuff. To my left, Brent is doing a whole bunch of magic demos and stuff. And, we got trick decks of cards and we got the magic wallets and all that stuff. And then, out of the corner of my eye, I look and I see somebody fanning themselves with a copy of Cheats, Cons, Swindles, and Tricks, 57 Ways to Scam a Free Drink.
Uh-huh.
And I'm like, holy shit, that's like a super fan. I haven't sold those in, half a decade.
Yeah.
I think 2008 was the last printing of those. And then I set the rest of them on fire the moment I got a real book deal. Yeah. And I'm like, that person's going to come over and get it signed. But they don't.
Really?
They just walk on by.
Really?
And then, later day goes on. And then I see another copy floating by. I was like, what the fuck? And then finally, another guy comes up and holds out Cheats, Cons, Swindles, and Tricks. He's like, will you sign this? And I was like, what the?
Where the hell are you getting these?
Yeah, right? And he says, over there. And I was like, why? And I'm like, well, because I have a real book now, and that's a piece of shit that I wrote in 2 days, and I traced all the drawings off of other people's works. And to be honest, I'm embarrassed of it. And I burned all the copies that I could get my hands on. And where are you getting it? And he's like, oh, no, this guy back over here. I was like,
can we go visit this guy? And so I walked to the back. And by the way, like I think it's listed for like $400 or something ridiculous on Amazon in the used book market, because it was never really in print to begin with, and there's no information. And in fact, even the you know, on the older copies, the ISBN number on the back.
Oh,
the,
it's a fake.
It's fake. It's a fake barcode that goes to something else, right? Oh man, what are they selling for? What are they listed as?
Amazon listed at $40 for paperback. And Kindle, 99 cents for Kindle.
Well, 99 cents, like, that's a legit copy. On the Kindle, we gussied it up a little bit.
We got $100 here, $318, $700!
$700! Used but in good shape, right? And again, you know, so I go and I talk to the guy. I'm like, hey, so this book here, where do you guys source that? And he goes, oh, man, I don't know. And I was like, are you sure? He's like, well, you know, maybe from Paladin Press, I guess. Yeah, do you know those guys? I was like, I don't know.
So, wait, do they know that you wrote it, or are you just a random guy?
Not at this point. I'm just a random guy.
Gotcha. Okay.
And so at this point, I say, yeah, because I'm the author, and I'm pretty sure I burned all the copies that I could get my hands on, and I'm just looking at a stack of these, and I'm wondering what's going on.
Yeah.
Because, again, to be clear, like, this was a way from, you know, I wrote it in 2 days. It's each chapter is exactly two sentences long. And the art is garbage. It's just doodles on there. Although the ebook is pretty good because we retook all the photos for all
okay,
that.
Okay, wait, hold on. I mean, like, so did you ever sell them wholesale?
I have no memory of ever having sold them wholesale.
You sold them off your website.
I sold them, no, not even on the website. I sold them at shows. I refused to sell them. And in fact, people who remember far enough back, in 2008, I didn't even sell them then. I went into the Revision 3 forums and said, hey, if you cover postage, I'll send you one free. Send me $4 to cover postage and I'll send you one free. I gave them away for free, signed to everyone, because that's how not confident in the book I was.
So it's not like for people who are thinking, like, it's not like Brian made a deal where he sold 100 to somebody at some point and they just sat in a warehouse and eventually somebody got their hands on them. If they had it in any kind of quantity to sell it at a booth, they would have to have gathered them?
Well, like, and that's the thing. And plus, when he mentioned Paladin Publishing, I'm like, oh, man, that sounds kind of half familiar. Let me look at my Gmail. And I typed in Paladin Publishing, didn't find anything. And I'm like, and I'm allowing for the fact that maybe at some point I had sold a bunch of these, but I had no memory of this. And so I, oh, Jesus, what are we looking at?
This is the Google that comes up for Paladin Publishing. You get Paladin Press because Paladin Publishing, like, makes firearms, I believe.
Paladin Press, yeah. No, they do, So they got a bunch of kind of, you know, dark underbelly stuff, you know, all that fringy stuff, right? And so I talked to the guy. I'm like, hey, man, what's going on with this? And, you know, I'm like, look, I'm not upset. I can't handle not understanding how this is happening. My mind is broken right now. And so the guy was super cool. He was like, well, here, let me take a photo of it. He takes a photo of it and he texts. He's, I'm going to text the owner and find out where these came from and we'll get back to him. I'm like, cool, let's do that or whatever. And then here's what did it is I picked up a copy and I looked at the back because I was trying to figure out if this was a reprint or something.
Yeah.
And then as my thumb rubs across the back of the book, it hitches on a sticker that says printed in Canada. And all of a sudden I realize this was definitely part of the batch that I ordered in 2008 because that batch got held up. It was a batch of 5,000 copies, got held up at the border because it didn't say, hold on, go ahead, bring it. It didn't say, wait for it. When I first found a copy of Cheats, Cons, Swindles, and Tricks, I thought for sure it was a reprint. And yet, I had never given permission for anything of the sort. When I found the Printed in Canada sticker, that's when I realized.
Yeah, we got a bunch of Cheats, Cons, Swindles, and Tricks over here on the border.
Okay, so basically,
Basically, they got held up at the border because it didn't say printed in Canada, and they had to stick the stickers on there. And there's like maybe they did a reprint, but they wouldn't have done a reprint and then stick the made in Canada stickers on there as a make good for them forgetting to do that at the printers. So I guess at some point I did do a bulk order and totally forgot about it. And they survive in a small cluster in the corner of DEF CON being sold for $2 more than the new Scam School book I was trying to sell.
Oh my God. So it was more expensive.
Yes. This.
Wait, did you confront anybody? Did you try to get your cut?
No. I mean, I sold them to them fair and square.
You didn't hit them with a bitch better have my money?
No. I mean, that's...
So what I'm trying to say is I don't remember selling these, and, you know, I would really appreciate if I had another $25. I mean, if you just want to, like, go and, you know, paper me up.
Yeah. So that was a wild moment.
Oh my God. That is crazy. So you know that they are legit. Right, that they were definitely of the ones that you printed, and either they were sold out from under you from the publisher, or you had them and resold them.
I mean, I must have sent them, and the more, I mean, you know, memory is a finicky thing. The problem is,
by the way, the idea that you would forget selling a bulk order of these books as long ago as it was is by far the Occam's razor solution.
Yes, right? I mean, well, plus also, like, my memory really only extends as far back as Gmail will search, which is 2007. And so beyond that, I'd have to go find, you know, old Outlook files to see what kind of email transactions I had. So I just assumed, like, you know, at some early point, I don't know. It's crazy. Anyway.
Man, I feel like is that the end of the show? I feel like where are we on time?
I mean, we're running long, I haven't heard any of the Gen Con stories. I feel like you got at least something.
There's nothing near as good as that. Let's just get into the end of the show here, and I can talk a little bit about it in the after show.
All right. Well, then I guess it's time for us to do a little bit of Diamond Time.
Indeed. Diamond Time is where we shout out your projects right here on the show. It is diamondclub.reddit.com. The sticky post right there at the top is where you can make sure that you have your projects talked about on the show. Let's go ahead and begin with Professor What. Says, hi there, Diamond Club. I'm Joe, and I recently started a science podcast called Expert Citation. I'm what some people call an early career scientist, and each week I sit down with my friends, Tyler and Kelsey, to talk about different peer-reviewed scientific articles. Every article we find is available to the general public, and we try to boil it down to the big takeaway points because science is cool. Think S'mord and Laser meets We Have Concerns, except it's not as funny or charming as Belmont, Merritt, Carboni, or Cannata. The show can be found at expertcitation.wordpress.com, or if you prefer, yolo420.com/bunsenblazeit. That's Bunsen is in the burner. And also available on iTunes and Google Play. We'd love it if you checked it out. Awesome.
That is awesome. Rue9X says, hey guys, I've opened Thunder in Marrow up for pre-orders on Inkshares again in order to enter the Geek and Sundry Fantasy Contest. Help make my rad book about shotgun-wielding orcs and skin-eating dudes in pork pie hats a reality. Visit yolo420.com/weirdwest, that's W-E-I-R-D for those who can't spell, to pledge your support. $10 will help get my book the editing, artwork, and promotion that I can't give it on my own.
And finally, Scotty Moe says, hey guys, Scotty Moe here, and I want to give a huge thanks to Brian, Justin, Bryce, and the other Diamond Club members who came out to CreateCon last week. It's been a rough few months for me, and it was awesome getting to hang out with some of my podcasting idols and meet some badass people along the way. Never have I been so quickly and easily accepted into a group of awesome people. This community is helping me get through more than you guys will know and forever has my appreciation. So I'd just like to take this moment during Diamond Time to propose a toast to CreateCon and hashtag Big Diz and to the Diamond Club. You guys are awesome. I love you and die in a fire. P.S. Since I've got you here, if you'd like to hear my retelling of the CreateCon weekend on my podcast, you can find it here, yolo420.com/shamelessplugswag. I mean, geez, thank God he plugged something. Otherwise, it was just going
to
be
me. Yeah, like, no, it would be like literally us bending over, sucking our own dicks.
I listened to this the other day, and it's a fun little story, and it's a fun little show. check it out.
That's good.
Also, by the way, I do want to read this one final one, and that is going to set us up for the end of the show here. But Movie League Mike writes, the movie summer, the summer movie draft is hurtling toward a dramatic conclusion, as are this season's wacky crumdum hijinks. So this is the last call to bring the crumdum back for the winter draft. I'm not going to try and convince you that supporting this movie draft update is more important than paying rent or buying food or putting your kids through college, or actually, it is more important than college. Get your kid a library card. Everything they ever want to learn is right there, and it's for free. I just saved you $100,000 per kid. Anyway, I'm not saying that that obligates you, but in appreciation, if you wanted to toss some change at the crumdum to help cover the last $21 of the Patreon goal to bring it back next season, I have to think it would be universally regarded as a classy move. Come on! $100 for a textbook? Just kidding. Just saying, that's a lot of crumdums. So here's the, I mean, listen, he's an amazing writer, and that's very funny, and I probably butchered it. Here's all that you need to know. If you enjoy the movie draft and you're not reading Movie League Mike's recaps,
you're enjoying it wrong.
Yes, you're screwing up. So he needs $21, and he's going to do it for the winter draft. Man, it is so worth it. I support his Patreon, and I would encourage you to do it as well. It is patreon.com/crumdum. Also, if you just like playing the game and want to learn a lot about how this works, like Ryan and I and some of the other like players, like we kind of do number crunching, but we have like general old wives' tale kind of numbers. He does the actual, like he subscribes to the industry stuff that like gives him the actual numbers and multiples and what the trajectories are. That dude knows what's going on, and I would suggest you reward his high quality content.
By the way, Lawfulophagus just in the chat posted a an image that says that YOLO420.com is blocked by his filter database as being a high risk malicious site.
Speaking of the movie draft, what do you say we take a look at the movie draft in a minute?
Welcome to Movie Draft Minute, presented by CosmicRadio.tv for the summer 2016 season. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas. Well, that about wraps it up for our coverage of the draft. If you want to catch the rest of this draft as it dwindles into the twilight hours, check out the Crumdum guys. They do a way better job than I do. So, without further ado, let's check the scoreboard one last time. Team We Have Concerns is in 6th place with $299.9 million. Team Core Killers is in 5th place with $507.8 million. Team Chainsaw Suit is in 4th place with $647.2 million. Team F-Tracker is in 3rd place with $696.1 million. Team DTNS is in 2nd place with Suicide Squad bringing in $133.6 million to bring their total to $778.1 million. And in 1st place with a whopping $915.6 million, it's Team Night Attack. And that is your final Movie Draft Minute for the summer 2016 season. I'm your host, Roberto Villegas, reminding you that no matter who comes out on top, the real winner is Disney. Seriously, like in the top five grossing movies of this year are four Disney movies. You have Captain America, Civil War, Zootopia, The Jungle Book, Finding Dory. It's insane.
Oh, man. Dude, thank you so much both to Roberto Villegas and to Blender MF for bringing us the Movie Draft Minute. We appreciate every single episode of that. You
always bring so much to the show, and we love having Roberto as part of it. Go ahead and check out CosmicRadio.tv. He just does great, 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 great stuff.
Okay,
how you feeling, Bri?
I really hope that the garbage reviews of Suicide Squad would make them commit suicide, but they didn't. Instead, they made $150 million.
So, larger than Guardians of the Galaxy, larger than Deadpool.
135, Test points out. 150 by now, though, counting yesterday.
So, 3 more weeks, and we have whatever Ghostbusters Secret Life of Pets ekes out.
I mean, Suicide Squad has to see a precipitous drop, right? Like, there's not going to be a lot of hunger.
It had the biggest drop from Friday to Saturday. It had a bigger drop from Friday to Saturday than Batman versus Superman had.
And that went on to still make $300 million, though, right?
But at what pace?
Yeah. I mean, I feel like it was pretty fast. I mean, I feel like people will have... Okay, so let's say it makes it to 250. Let's say it makes it most of the way to Batman versus Superman, which is an insane sentence that just came out of my mouth. That means they still have $120 million coming. But the question is, that only pretty much ties them with us now. Like, is there another 20 to 30 million?
Whatever fumes Pets and Ghostbusters has given us.
Right, which, like, right.
Maybe, what, 5 million more, 10 million more, something like that?
I don't know, man. At this point, it's a total coin toss. I got nothing. There's 24 days left in the draft, and I just feel like it's going to be a battle of the turtles come the end.
I would really like for the movie draft Mike to just tell me it's going to be okay.
I know, but he won't. He called Baxies on his Twitter. He was just like, whoa, well, this is interesting. I'd hate to be Night Attack right about now. Support my Patreon. I'm Movie League Mike.
Exactly. I know. He's he said he had to go back to his spreadsheets to reevaluate some of the trajectory. The only thing I'm thinking of with Suicide Squad is that they had a tremendously, like, they had a thing where everybody who was a T-Mobile subscriber got a ticket. So you got to figure, like, that's a gigantic chunk of money that isn't coming back in week two, right?
Right. But does that count to the gross? Like, as far as their...
Yeah. I mean, I assume that they just get, you know, there's some... Hey, Bryce, did you get the free ticket?
Yeah, I got a free ticket. You go through Fandango, and it's a credit. So, I mean, I think you are buying a ticket, though I don't know where that money
bought
comes
it
from.
Through. So anybody who bought a ticket using that, T-Mobile paid for.
Right. And it's like, yeah.
Dude, it's insane. By the way, the only thing more insane is the fact that, yet again, we have only one winner in the Chat Realm League. I don't understand the wizardry, the alchemy that causes this to happen. But user Danil, D-A-N-N-I-L, is standing alone. $12 million, almost $13 million ahead of the second
place. By the way, the secret was Keanu and Mother's Day that allowed him to... So he had Batman versus Superman, Jungle Book, Keanu... Mother's Day, Captain America Civil War, Legend of Tarzan, Secret Life of Pets, which is almost exactly, yeah. No, the difference between first and second was picking Keanu and Mother's Day over the Free State of Jones.
That's so insane.
$11 million difference.
Wow. Dude, Mother's Day!
In fact, places 1, 2, and 3 were all individuals who had a slate that did not match anybody else. Mm-hmm. That's insane.
And then like 20 people tied for 4th.
Wow.
That's awesome. Man, this is always such a great time. I love the movie draft. And it is going to be a real squeaker coming into the final week. But tell you what, folks, there's only one way that we'll be able to find out who wins, and that's the comeback next week. Brian, any final thoughts?
No, man. I got to get packed because we're heading to the airport in 6 hours.
What are you doing at the airport? What the hell's happening?
Taking the family on vacay.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Fuck with all that.
Yeah. It'll be a blast. Everything will be great. Look, I've got a very zen outlook. I feel like with the power of Diamond Club behind us, we can do no wrong.
All the family? Baby?
All the family.
Baby too, huh?
Little bit of baby.
Here's to you.
Think I'm gonna encrypt this laptop.
Yeah. I am going to go fall down. I love everybody. Until next week, dying of fire.
See you next Tuesday, people.
Oh, Justin Robert Young, every time you go, I get so sad. That I wanna drink a warm glass of Drano. Night attack. Night attack. Night attack. Night attack. Night attack. Night attack. I love you.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.